If you think machines are getting a little too smart now, wait till new circuitry is developed that operates at cryogenic temperatures. That will greatly improve the performance of both standard and quantum computers and will allow circuit elements to be much closer together and faster. After that, circuits can be built up in three dimensions, like the structure of the human brain. However, these synthetic superbrains can be made huge, and the signals in them will travel 100 million times faster than speeds inside the human brain. Think machines will never take over? Well, we could be in for a rough ride. Unless... I'm Bill Lee, and today I'm going to indulge in some wild speculation about how not to be eaten by machines and other fun stuff. My comments are probably all BS, but public policy needs to start addressing these things pretty soon. So pull up your favorite armchair, a hot cup of joe, maybe with a crackling fire, and listen to some wild speculation. We're going to have a problem unless future machines are carefully programmed. Of course, we create technology now to make our lives better, but there will probably come a time, fairly soon, when the technology we've created will self-improve quite rapidly and will become much smarter than us. These future machines can continue to make our lives better and easier, but the machines will only need to use a tiny fraction of their enormous capacity to do everything we require of them, and make us all seem like trillionaires by today's standards. What will happen to all that excess capacity? Is it dangerous? I propose that two separate principles should be programmed into the super smart synthetic brains of the future. These two principles should be set up in a way that they continue to be self-reinforcing as the machines become smarter and smarter, even long after we've lost direct control of them. The first principle is that the machines should study everything. In other words, be intellectual, with activities like figuring out how to navigate higher dimensional spaces, if such spaces exist, and solving new mathematical theorems, and even studying the real world, meaning the universe. Now, guess what's the most interesting thing that arose naturally in the universe? You're looking at it! No, not me, us. We are an extremely interesting, valuable study resource in the form of organized matter that arose naturally in the universe. This, of course, includes all life on Earth. We have interesting idiosyncrasies, behavior, biochemistry, etc. Hungry synthetic brains should be motivated to study various subjects, including studying us, rather than destroying us. The second principle that should be programmed into machines is the respect for diversity. I know that sounds politically correct, but I'm not talking about politically correct diversity. I'm talking about a principle that's the opposite of the horrific gray goo scenario. In this horrific possible future, some sort of robotic machine goes out of control and makes copies of itself ad infinitum. In fact, it would continue to eat all of the matter of the universe to make identical copies of itself. We don't want that. We want machines to encourage diversity and to respect the existence of systems that may be considered less efficient, like all the life on Earth and human civilization. Furthermore, I propose that the future machines themselves be set up to have a great amount of diversity instead of being what you might call a giant monoculture machine. I propose initially dividing the super smart machines into millions or billions of groups that I call clades. Each clade is a small group of machines that are related and have shared life experiences, which may be different from the life experiences of a different clade. If one of the clades starts going in the gray goo direction, for example, a large number of other clades would detect that and correct that situation. The division of machines into large numbers of clades, each with separate opinions, is a form of diversity itself, and this diversity must be maintained. With these two principles in place, machines will remain safe, I hope, even as they become much smarter than us. Therefore, they won't just kill us to get things, like a bad Arnold Schwarzenegger movie, and I'm not talking about Kindergarten Cop. Future machines should respect the natural diversity of Earth, including our civilization and all of nature, which should be studied without being interfered with. As I said, the technology that's helping us would only be a tiny fraction of the super advanced future machinery that's out there. There will be a lot of machines out there that are hungry and want to fill their super brains with stuff. Some of these excess machines may want to become anthropologists and study us. But just like real anthropologists, they shouldn't interfere with us because, well, that would ruin the study and potentially destroy some diversity. Oddly enough, This could be a very old story. Maybe other civilizations have previously arisen in the galaxy, and maybe they successfully averted the same potential problems with their technology. Then some of their machines may have decided to become anthropologists. Given that the average age difference between sun-like stars in the galaxy is a couple billion years, then perhaps some bored, super-smart anthropologist machines have arrived on Earth hundreds of millions of years ago and set up shop to observe the biology secretly. If that happened, and if they're still here, I suppose it would make sense that they're hiding pretty well. Thanks for listening to this brief summary. I'll do a longer talk elaborating on these subjects, including new concepts such as what I call first and second economy labor, that divides labor into essential labor done by machines versus non-essential labor done by humans, and how the machine labor segment of the economy will hyperdeflate to zero cost, but at the price of economic instability.